This is my anchor of hope for this people in the future.
With those words, the founder of the Dutch colony in western Michigan, Albertus Christian van Raalte, dedicated a tiny school in 1851. The school grew into an academy, the academy into a college. And the Anchor of Hope College has been a symbol ever since 1866 of a sound and challenging opportunity for education. Hope College's $5 million campus covers more than two city blocks in Holland, Michigan, and it's expanding rapidly into a larger area. Holland is the perfect setting for a small modern college, friendly and progressive, its clean, bright homes and streets sparkling in the sunlight like a bit of Netherlands transplanted to Michigan. During May, the whole countryside blazes with the colors of rich Dutch tulips, and the Tulip Time Festival attracts thousands of visitors from all over America. Here at Hope in Holland, a student can realize a broad view of knowledge and culture, a true study of liberal arts in a distinctively Christian framework. Hope covers a vast range of interests and fields, excellent in the traditional areas of learning, and as a training ground for church leaders, Hope is also outstanding in science, languages, business, and the humanities. Whatever the field, Hope's approach is one of significance, and this is the reason that so many men and women of Hope have become leaders in their professions. High goals were set for Hope in the very beginning, at the time of the inauguration of Hope's first president, Dr. Philip Phelps. Dr. Isaac N. Wyckoff, one of the greatest leaders of what was then called the Reformed Protestant Dutch Church in America, spoke with inspired insight into the problems of the 20th century. He said that Hope first must teach the languages of the world, for the world was shrinking, and we must learn to be at home in it. Second, he said Hope must teach the sciences, for this is an age of science, and only those who are expert can provide the information and techniques needed for leadership and survival. Third, he stated that Hope must teach moral science and train leaders for the church, for without college-trained leaders, a denomination cannot survive. Dr. Wyckoff's challenge has been met with courage and determination by Hope College, which now ranks as one of the top 10 co-educational colleges in the United States. Two things make Hope great. First is her exciting heritage. Second, her people, her faculty and staff, and her students. For every dozen students, there is a teacher. This ratio of professors to pupils gives every student the opportunity for thorough individual attention and a close relationship to his instructors that helps him accomplish a more complete realization of himself as an individual and in the world in which he lives. The campus is compact. In a pinch, you can get from one end to the other in less than 5 minutes, and this makes it easier for students to reach their teachers and advisors. It's easier to go to the library to double-check that not-quite-remembered fact, and the offices of the president and his staff are convenient, and the doors open to any student with a problem to discuss. The students are all above average, for the entrance requirements are high at Hope. These men and women come from nearly all our states and from a large number of foreign countries, too. Two-thirds of the hometowns are in Michigan. While 65% are members of the Reformed Church in America, some 19 other denominations are represented, and there are no bars of prejudice at Hope regarding religion, race, or color. The professors are exceptionally well qualified. Over 45% of them are entitled to be called doctor. Nearly half of them took their own first college training here and have returned to teach where they were taught. This is a science class in the field of biology. Miss Van Skark is demonstrating the phenomenal size of certain edible mushrooms to these young botanists. Intimate lecture classes with vivid examples and demonstrations are the rule at Hope, and the lecturers maintain close contact with the students and with the revolutionary changes in the fields in which they teach. The Hope way is to give each student personal contact with the experience of his teachers. The man or woman who attends Hope is never just a serial number in a class with 500 others. Small classes have 1,000 advantages. The contact of mind to mind is direct and clear. The students are able to know each other well and to stimulate and assist each other in discussion and debate. And while the sight of students standing at a blackboard with chalk in hand may seem old-fashioned in an age of missiles and satellites and computing machines, these traditional methods are linked at Hope to radically new methods that take advantage of the best in modern technology. An excellent example is the language laboratory.
Wie hat es Ihnen gefallen?
Sehr gut. Morgen wollen wir das Museum besuchen.
French, German, Spanish, Latin, and Greek are taught through the use of tape recorders with which the students may hear the language spoken by an expert, often native instructors, and then record his own voice and listen to the playback, comparing his pronunciation to that which he knows is correct. The lab has 20 acoustical booths and a huge library of recordings.
Oh, ich habe Gelder drüben auf einer Bank.
The microscope, a Dutch invention, plays an important part in the scientific education of Hope's collegians. Many Hope graduates are engaged in scientific research. One is a vice president in charge of research for a New Jersey pharmaceutical firm. Another young Hope graduate is doing hormone research at the National Health Institute. Still another is the head of the Institute of Microbiology at Rutgers University, where he succeeded a Nobel Prize winner. Since 1936, nearly 150 Hope men and women have received doctorates in the sciences. Hope stands with the top 10% in America in this regard. Nearly two-thirds of these PhDs have been earned in chemistry, where Hope's chemistry department is outstanding. The program including summer research grants for undergraduates, an unusual opportunity for the undergraduate. In theology, Hope is a real leader, having among its graduates 10 presidents of Reformed Church colleges and 8 seminary presidents. Hope has produced nearly 700 ordained ministers and almost 200 missionaries. 4 faculty members in the departments of religion and religious education guide the Christian study at Hope. The arts are a strong voice at Hope, and the new music building provides facilities for classrooms, studios, private rehearsal rooms, and an auditorium for concerts. When organ students have acquired enough proficiency, they are allowed to work on this magnificent Skinner 4-manual organ in the Dimnent Chapel. In the fields of organ music and in choir directing, future church leaders receive further training for their careers at Hope. Drama and painting and sculpture are all part of the cultural atmosphere at Hope. But it's the music department that is best known, for many persons far from Holland have heard the choir or orchestra on tour or on network radio broadcasts. For instrumentalists, the orchestra, band, and the select symphonette are challenging activities, and there are smaller ensembles for those who love the more intimate sound of chamber music. Musical education may be had in these groups and in class or private instruction. About 8 hours a day, Hope students may listen to WTAS, a closed-circuit commercial radio station. Speech and drama students have the opportunity to work under actual conditions of commercial radio operation, although the programming is tailored admittedly to collegiate tastes. WTAS began in the dormitory room of a student, and in only 1 year grew to occupy 3 rooms in Collin Hall, the men's dormitory. Music is the major attraction, but news, including local and campus news, is broadcast daily. It isn't a bit unusual to see a student and one of his professors engaged in conversation at an odd corner of the campus at most any hour of the day. Relationships at Hope are close enough that this wonderfully informal kind of relationship exists everywhere. Lasting relationships grow from this, and nearly all alumni remember Laura Boyd, who taught at Hope from 1921 to 1955 and still lives near the campus. The first campus building inside the Hope College gate is the Graves Library, a scene of serious study since 1894. All advanced study requires research, and the library staff at Hope has worked hard to keep sources and references up to date in this world of expanding science and exploding technology. At Hope, the most modern policy is followed. The book stacks are open to the students for reading or research. Hope presents to each student the challenge of being responsible for a great part of his own education, and the library gives every Hope man and woman greater access to a wide variety of material. Garrett John Van Zoren, a retired Zeeland, Michigan businessman, made a gift of over $500,000 in securities for the construction of a new library, vitally needed, in memory of his wife, Anna Elizabeth Van Zoren, who had recently passed away. This was the largest gift ever received by Hope, and it will serve to open new horizons of learning for all future students. The Van Zoren Library will be a part of the $3 million expansion program now underway. Books are the keys to knowledge, and the vast storehouse of information and wisdom resides on the shelves of Hope's library. This is the Kletz, the coffee shop and snack bar on the ground floor of Van Ralty Hall in the center of the campus. Whether you can't wait till the next meal or if your hunger is more for the conversation that goes with a coffee break, this is the place. Many friendships that begin in classes grow in the Kletz as the vital issues of the day, whether yesterday's lab assignment or next week's game, or tonight's date is the topic under discussion. While it's definite that no one ever earned an A in the Kletz, it's a pretty safe bet that you'll find a professor and a group of students here anytime you drop in having an informal discussion or just enjoying each other's company. The Kletz is a favorite spot for couples, too, particularly when chilly afternoons make it more pleasant to be indoors than the stroll around the campus. Drama students and those who participate from pure love of the theater have several chances a year to display their talents in productions of the Palette and Mask Society. The techniques involved in makeup, costuming, staging, and lighting are taught at Hope. And while the work of theatrical production is hard, the rewards of applause make it all worthwhile. This was a dramatic moment in Carl Coppock's play R.U.R., a prophetic play of robots and automation that predicted some of the problems we are experiencing now and which provided an exciting evening of pure theater. One out of 10 students graduated from Hope received scholarship, fellowship, or assistantship for graduate work, and many undergrads are on scholarships. A number of other students are able to help pay their way through college with jobs on the campus. Every basket of leaves is another step toward a degree. Many young men punch this time clock at the cafeteria, where they serve as waiters and busboys. And there are others who are pearl divers or members of the Silver Squadron in the kitchen of the cafeteria. In order to qualify for these jobs, the students must maintain their grade averages at a required level. Assignments are made each spring for the following year, and this young man works in the reception office at Collin Hall, the men's dormitory. He handles all incoming telephone calls and serves as information bureau. When a call arrives for one of the men in the hall, he looks up the room number of that student and buzzes him on the intercom. Each room is equipped with a personal intercom, so Collin Hall has no blaring loudspeakers in the hallways. In Collin Hall, down the corridor from radio station W2EAS, many of the men use the laundry room. Equipped with automatic washers and dryers, this convenient laundry facility may be one of the reasons that Hope men are always a bit neater looking than the usual conception of the college man. Hope men have built a cyclotron and an astronomical telescope, but the esoteric science of ironing a shirt seems a little tougher to accomplish for some scholars. The methods may be unorthodox, but the job does get done. While the laundry is in the works, Collin men can relax in the recreation room, complete with ping-pong tables and an automatic coin-operated snack bar. A real landmark of any college is the dormitory bull session. Men always talk of sports and young ladies, of politics and young ladies, of tough professors and young ladies. And these men of Hope spend a lot of time in serious discussion of their classes and courses and their plans for the future. The bull session is a part of the important process of learning to live together, and the friendly atmosphere of Hope makes this a pretty easy assignment. The paddles on the dresser are strictly symbolic, for hazing in any form is forbidden at Hope. But they frame together important activity at Hope, the social side of college life. While this young man straightens his tie, a special young lady is engaged in similar preparations in her dormitory. A touch of the brush, the spray of some secret and exotic preparation, and everything is nearly ready. The lounge at Durfee Hall is comfortable, and a good thing, too, for no co-ed in her right mind would arrive exactly on time. After everything from editorials to classified ads have been read at least once, his date is ready. ¶¶ now the ritual, the sign out at the desk. Time of departure, destination, expected time of return, escort. There, all the details are down on paper. It's a beautiful afternoon at Hope. The air is crisp and the October sun is friendly. It's a perfect day for a drive through the fantasy of Michigan's autumn colors. When they return to the dorm, there's always a quiet conversation before they say goodnight. And this is an excellent place for a discreet pause in narration. Here's a warm tradition at Hope. Couples who come together in the atmosphere of Hope College often like each other and sometimes fall in love and make plans for a future together. When the boy belongs to a fraternity, this usually results in pinning. He gives her his fraternity pin as a token of his love and as a symbol that they are engaged to be engaged. When this happens, the whole fraternity turns out to serenade the couple. What they may lack as a chorus, they more than make up for in friendly enthusiasm. The president has the privilege of presenting a floral tribute and a tender kiss. Then, it's the couple's turn. What a splendid experience the men and women of Hope have in learning the lessons in their courses of study and in learning to know and get along with each other. These students are America's real hope for the future. It isn't all intellect or romance at Hope. Contests of the athletic field fulfill other needs of her students. These soccer players are part of the extensive intramural program at Hope, and the sports include bowling, golf, volleyball, tennis, and track, among others. Teams are organized on a class, dormitory, or society basis, and the prizes are trophies. The girls aren't left out of sports either. The Women's Athletic Association offers field hockey, softball, basketball, badminton, tennis, bowling, and many other activities. The program includes teams and tournaments and awards, and the opportunity to represent Hope in meets with other colleges. Hope is a member of the Michigan Intercollegiate Athletic Association, along with Adrian, Albion, Alma, Calvin, Hillsdale, Kalamazoo, and Olivet. Hope fields teams in basketball, track, baseball, golf, tennis, and cross country, as well as in football. These contests are hard fought and hard won, for the competition is extremely keen among these Michigan schools. Here, head football coach Russ DeVette and his associates Gordon Brewer and Ken Weller run the team through a fast-paced practice session for a tough game ahead, the annual clash with powerful Hillsdale. On the day before the game, Dean Budhinger, for years the keystone of athletic and sports activities at Hope, spotted two small boys looking at Hope's case full of prized trophies. He took time out to explain each one, reliving as he did so some of the glory that Hope's Flying Dutchmen have won in the past. Give these boys 15 years and good grades, and they may be in the Hope backfield. The day for the game dawned, wet and cold, and the large, heavy players of Hillsdale faced the prospect of fighting Hope on a sea of mud. Then the Flying Dutchmen of Hope College took the field, and they were met with a cheer from a stand full of fans. The excitement of the crowd was whipped higher by the Hope College band as the two team captains got together for the coin-tossing ceremony, and Hope won the toss. Pope elected to receive, and Hillsdale kicked off across the soggy battlefield. Chilly under their white jerseys, Hope's Flying Dutchmen launched an attack, but the mud slowed them down. They drove deep into Hillsdale territory, then lost the ball on downs. Hillsdale had no better luck with the mud than Hope, and they were forced to punt. The Dutchmen tried to gain yardage on the ground, but they had a tough time bucking the heavier Hillsdale team. Hope's backs might be faster, but in the swampy mire, Hillsdale's heavier horsepower had an advantage. An aerial attack failed because the receivers just couldn't get there in time. The optimism of the cheerleaders was contagious, and the Hope fans shouted their encouragement, but things didn't look so good. The mud turned white jerseys to dark brown and spirits to black. But still, the cheerleaders and the crowd gave no more ground than the Dutchmen on the field. If Hillsdale won, they know they'd have a tough battle. The team fights as hard as Hope always does. A few scrapes and bruises are inevitable. But the setback of this player's mishap set the enthusiasm of the fans on fire again. The battle raged on that sodden field down near the goal line, and never did the Hope's spirit falter. Time was running out in the first half, and every player threw himself into the fight. The men and women in the stands and the cheerleaders went through it all, right along with the players. They tasted the mud and felt the jarring impact of a couple of 200-pound players coming head-on, neither man giving an inch. Then it was halftime, time to drag themselves back to the locker room to rest and get the mud out of their eyes and get a pep talk from Russ DeVette before the second half began. The Hope spirit on the athletic field and in later life has a solid foundation in religion. Defeats are smaller, triumphs are much greater when they're shared with God. Each day at Hope begins with a message of encouragement and faith in the Dimnet Chapel. Here men and women of 20 different denominations come together to find peace and beauty and to erase many cares and worries that may linger from the day before and to find new strength, new confidence, new help from the most ancient source for solving the problems of the new day. From the very beginning of Hope College, religion has been a vital part of Hope life. Hope's motto, Spero in Deo, Hope Thou in God, is part of the overall plan that is devised to strengthen the Christian faith of the faculty, staff, and students of Hope. In introducing the student to the vast sum of human knowledge, Hope guides them to an understanding of the uncountable riches of religion and helps him to a full realization of life's problems and responsibilities that he as a Christian must face. This heritage of faith gives each Hope student a strong sense of direction, reaffirming his belief in God and instilling in him a belief in himself as a Christian, while giving him the intellectual tools he needs to make of this world a better place for every man. From the chapel to the day's work refreshed and revitalized, many of Hope's men and women go on to become strong members of their home churches. Some few of them dedicate their lives to the service of God, entering such schools as nearby Western Theological Seminary to become ordained ministers of the church, or to become missionaries to carry the word to all places with calm courage. Graduation at Hope is a real commencement, a beginning of a rich life, as well as the initial fulfillment of 4 years of study. This is a moment to remember for all time, that moment of leaving the Hope campus and searching for the endless horizons of the world. When a student is graduated, Hope doesn't forget him. Alumni Secretary Marion Stryker is proud to know of the accomplishments of Hope's graduates, whose records are kept up to date at Hope. Hope's philosophy is simple and direct and well expressed by Dr. Irwin J. Lubbers, who became president in 1945.
Hope, the name of our college, is descriptive of aspiration. Its symbol, the anchor, is a reminder that this aspiration is founded in conviction and faith. The presuppositions underlying our fellowship as faculty and students are all distinctly Christian. We strive earnestly in all of our work, in our leisure, in our diversions, and in the various disciplines, to face frankly all new frontiers, to challenge fearlessly any false philosophies or ideologies, and to perform our designated tasks faithfully. Our primary objective is to provide that environment in the classroom and in the laboratory and on the playing field which will develop those qualities of body and mind and spirit and unfolding personality which are the finest flower of education, the Christian scholar.
An attitude and expression such as this could not exist in a college content to stand still. New construction is underway in the expansion program, which will cost $3 million. The program includes a new $1 million library, a $600,000 addition to science laboratory and classroom facilities, an athletic field, campus improvements, an art and dramatics facility, and a necessary addition to endowment funds. A debt of progress is owed to the founders and leaders of Hope, to the 9,000 graduates who've gone out into the world from her campus, and to the generation of students, some not yet born, who will come here. In looking ahead with hope, we can see the fulfillment of the initial dreams for hope, and we can see the answer to something that was said by William Allen White. If Christianity is to survive, it must survive in the environment made by Christian leaders. It cannot survive in the atmosphere that is thickening with modern paganism. Unless those who believe in a Christian civilization are willing to sacrifice their hard-earned cash to educate Christian leaders, they will find in a few generations that their dream has vanished. This dream is secure in the future of Hope College. Hope has proved her place in her church, in her community, her state, her nation, and in the world. But this is no grounds for complacency. Hope is too dynamic to stand still. That's why we're looking ahead with hope.